country, a great country, and as you know, some of you may know, I'm going to the Vatican on Thursday night. And the topic of the conference in which I'll be speaking is something that Pope Francis has been extraordinarily brilliant and brave in talking about, and that is how we need to create a moral economy. A moral economy. So let's follow up. You got little kids. Well, before we even get to little kids, let's talk about this one. Today in New York City, today in Vermont, women are having beautiful babies. Now, if well, some are not so beautiful. What if you're a parent? If you're a parent, you think that the big gay babies are beautiful. I've got four kids, I know about that. All right. They all turned out okay. So stop and think about this. Just stop and think. If the mom, and there are millions of these mothers, is working class or low income, she has a baby today. The likelihood is that in a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, what happens? She is forced to be separated from that baby, go back to work in order to earn the income she needs to take care of her family. And by the way, as long as I live, I will never know how single mothers do it. That I will never know. If you want the real heroines of this country, I literally don't know. I don't know how you raise a kid all by yourself, how you go to work and make the income to do that, deal with child care and everything else. Unbelievable. But here's the point. We are the only major country on Earth, actually one of the very few countries on Earth, that does not guarantee paid family and medical leave. Right? And that means that while in other countries, moms and dads can stay home from work 4 months, 6 months, 8 months, in our country, if you're poor, you're working class, you may have to be separated from your baby in 2 or 3 weeks, go back to work. That is outrageous. That is unacceptable. And that is why we're going to pass good legislation, co-sponsored, introduced by your senator, Kirsten Gillibrand, which will provide 3 months paid family and medical leave every family. Okay, baby is born. Okay, now what happens to the baby? Well, mom, dad, in most cases, this family's mom, dad go to work. Mom goes to work. Child goes to child care or pre-K. And let's be honest about this. Do we have any psychologists in the room? All right, there's a psychologist. All right. What? Okay, that counts. What psychologists tell us is the most important years of human development. Intellectually and emotionally, a 0 to 4. That's a little shame. Think about what we do to the little kids. We have a dysfunctional child care and pre-K system where many of the people working with those kids, getting McDonald's-type wages, don't have adequate training, don't have any benefits, don't see it as a career. What we have got to do is revolutionize child care and pre-K education in America. We want all of our little ones to be able to go to school curious, healthy, intellectually alive. We can do that, but we're going to have to hire hundreds of thousands of well-trained, well-paid, dedicated teachers who work with the most vulnerable kids in the country. Then you go to school. Well, I'm a product of New York City public schools. A few years ago, I went to PS 197, and then I went to James Madison High School. Had a pretty good basketball team, if I do say so myself. And we got a pretty good education. But now, you look at public schools all over this country, and many of the kids are not getting the quality education they need. In city after city, many of the school buildings are falling apart. In major cities like Detroit or Chicago, really, really serious problems with public education. What do we have to do? It's not a radical idea. We are living in a society where education is the key to human development. Now, you know, I like football as much as the next person. But you know what? Actually, teachers do more important work than football. And that means, as a nation, we have to change our culture to appreciate the importance of education, to honor teachers, to make sure that as a nation, we can do that. So we create a strong public school system where the best and brightest understand the joy of going into teaching and they're proud of their profession. But then we also have to understand that in many respects, a high school degree 50 years ago was the equivalent of what a college degree is today because of changes in technology. Right, the simple truth is that today to make it into the middle class, you need more education than somebody did 50 years ago because of the changes in the economy. I grew up in a family, did not have a lot of money, my parents never went to college. Millions of families in the same boat. What I think we have got to do is make it very clear that when we talk about public education today, we're not just talking about first grade through 12th grade. We have got to make public colleges and universities tuition free. A radical idea. I'll tell you what it was a radical idea. 100 or so years ago, working class people said, we don't want our kids working in factories or farms. We want our kids to get a free public education. 100 years ago, they said it. First grade through 12th grade. That was pretty radical back then. But today, the idea of making public colleges and universities not a new and unique idea, not something I invented. In Germany, you all know, you know, in Germany it exists. In Scandinavia it exists. And here's something that you may not know. It virtually existed in this country 50 years ago. Fifty years ago, you had great public universities like City College, Brooklyn College, Queens College. Now somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but my memory is that tuition 40, 50 years ago was virtually free, all right? All right. University of California, tuition virtually free. Other colleges, all public colleges and universities, all over this country. Why is it that 50 years later, when we are in many ways a wealthier country than we were then, why is college increasingly unaffordable for so many of our families? And why are so many people leaving school deeply in debt? No, that's the question we have to answer. So, what we're going to do is two things. Number one, make public colleges and universities tuition free. Number two, make it possible for millions of people who have student debt to refinance their debt at the lowest great so I can find. Now, I have talked to people all over this country from coast to coast, and people who are $50,000, $100,000 in debt. Young woman in my home city, Burlington, Vermont, went to medical school. Her dream, she's now a doctor in a community health center, came out of school, $300,000 in debt. Dentist in Iowa, $400,000 in debt. Kid I met on the campaign trail, dropped out of college 2 years, $60,000 in debt. Guy I met in Nevada, he has been paying off his student debt for 25 years. He's more in debt today than he was when he took it out. It is insane. Of course it's insane. And this is what thinking outside of the box, outside of the status quo is like. Take a deep breath and you say, okay, nobody disagrees that it is enormously important for us to get the best education that we can from a human perspective and from an economic perspective. We need the best educated workforce. Why are we punishing people severely for getting the education they need? It is insane. The beauty and the significance of making public education through university and college level free is not just that it saves people money when they don't go into debt. That's very important. But think what else it does, which is even more important. As I said, I grew up in a family that did not have a lot of money. My parents didn't go to college. For millions of families in this country, for kids from low-income families, the idea of going to college is about as realistic as going to the moon. It's not within their world purview. And what I want to see happen is I want every parent, every teacher, every kid in America to understand that if those children do their schoolwork well, if they take school seriously, yes, regardless of the income of their families, they will be able to get a college degree. Is pretty revolutionary. Now, people say, well, Bernie, you know, you're a nice guy, you're Santa Claus, you're giving away everything, all this free stuff. The term is free stuff. I'm giving away all of this free stuff. And how are you going to pay for it? Well, that's a fair question. What I am proposing costs about $70 billion a year. That's a lot of money. How are we going to pay for it? Okay, let's go back a little bit. About 8 years, our good friends on Wall Street. Not really, my good friends. I have to be honest with you. Not really. All right, their greed, their recklessness, and their illegal behavior drove this economy into the worst economic downturn since the Great Depression. I don't know about that. And then, after destroying half the economy, these guys went crying to Wall Street, to the Congress, and said, bail us out. We'll be good boys. Bail us out. And Congress, against my vote, did bail us out. But I think right now, in 2016, it is time to tell them that we will impose a tax on Wall Street speculation, which will bring in more than enough money to pay for free tuition in public colleges and universities and low-wage student debt. If we can bail out the illegal behavior of Wall Street, then Wall Street can help the working families of this country. This campaign is listening to the American people and not just the wealthy campaign contributors. And that is why we're going to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. This campaign is listening to senior citizens and disabled veterans. And they cannot make it, nor can anybody make it, on $11,000 or $12,000 a year Social Security. Cannot be done. Now, with millions of seniors struggling to buy the medicine they need, the health care they need, heating their homes, our Republican friends have come up with a brilliant concept in Congress. They said, let's cut Social Security dollars. I don't think so. No. We're not going to cut Social Security benefits. We're going to expand Social Security benefits. And by the way, that is not a hard thing to do. Many of the senior groups are demanding, and I agree with them, that we lift the cap on taxable income. Right now, you have somebody making $5 million a year, somebody making $118,000. They're both contributing the same amount into the Social Security Trust Fund. You lift the cap, you go up, start off at $250,000 and above. And if you lift the cap, and you have people making millions, making the same percentage of their income into the trust fund as somebody making $40,000 a year, we can extend the life of Social Security for 58 years and increase benefits for seniors living under $16,000 a year by $1,300 a year. This is not a radical idea. This is exactly what Barack Obama campaigned on in 2008. Now, Hillary Clinton opposed this idea in 2008. She has yet to be clear about her views on this. So I challenge Secretary Clinton today. Tell us, are you prepared to lift the cap on taxable income and increase benefits for millions of workers? This campaign is listening to women. And what women are telling me is they are tired of working for 79 cents on the dollar compared to men. They want the whole damn dollar. Trillions of dollars to spend in a war in Iraq that we never should have gotten into. But apparently we don't have enough money to rebuild inner cities all across this country. In this city, whether it is New York Housing Authority apartments or other apartments, we need to rebuild our housing stock and build millions of units across this country of affordable housing. We need to oppose gentrification and protect working class neighborhoods. I was in the South Bronx a week or so ago, and they were telling me that one out of four children in that particular community has asthma from breathing the crap that's in the air. We have schools that are physically deteriorating. We have unemployment rates that are far, far too high. We have got to understand that if we can rebuild the infrastructure of Iraq and Afghanistan, we sure as hell can rebuild America's inner cities and our own. A $1 trillion investment over a five-year period will go a long way to rebuilding our roads, our bridges, water systems, wastewater plants, affordable housing, levees, and dams, and create up to 13 million decent paying jobs. Yeah, and by the way, we got legislation in to make it easier for workers to join unions. Without a strong trade union movement, we will never have a strong middle class. So thank you very much. This campaign is listening to our brothers and sisters in the Latino community. And they are telling me that with 11 million undocumented people in this country, many of whom are being exploited. We don't talk about that too much. But if you don't have any legal rights, you know what? You are underpaid, you are cheated, and you have no capability of fighting back. All right? You got it. I agree with the Latino community that we have got to move toward comprehensive immigration reform and a path towards citizenship. And if Congress does not do its job, I will use the executive powers of the presidency to do everything that I can. Our goal must be to unite families, not divide families. This campaign is listening to a group of people who get very, very little attention, and that is the Native American community. Anybody who has read 5 minutes of American history understands that from before we were officially a country, when the first settlers came here, the Native Americans were lied to, they were cheated, and many treaties negotiated with them were broken. We owe the Native American people more than we can ever repay. They have taught us more than anything the need to understand that as human beings we are part and one with nature, and that we cannot destroy nature if our people are survived. I was just in Wisconsin the other day, and somebody there told me, think about the impact of those decisions for seven generations forward. In this country today, corporate America thinks about the decisions about how much money they can make in the next 3 months and to help with anything else.
I think we got to learn something from the Native American community.
Which takes me to an issue that the Native American people and all of us are deeply concerned about. I am a member of the U.S. Senate Committee on the Environment, and what I can tell you is that the debate is over. Climate change is real. It is caused by human activity. And it is already causing devastating problems in our country and around the world. And what the scientists are also very clear about, and they're getting really, really nervous, because what they are saying is many of the projections they have been making may have underestimated the impact of climate change. So what they are saying is if we don't act in an incredibly bold way, aggressive way, we're going to be looking at more and more drought, more floods, more extreme weather disturbances, more rising sea levels, more acidification of the ocean, and more wars and conflicts all over the world as people fight for limited natural resources. So what we have got to do from a moral perspective is to appreciate that we have got to leave this planet in a way that is healthy and habitable for our kids and our grandchildren. That means, in a very unequivocal way, telling the fossil fuel industry that their short-term profits are not more important than the future of this planet. You know, I have seven very beautiful grandchildren, and I never once, long after I'm gone, I don't want them to be living in a world where they and millions of other children say, why didn't they do something when they knew what was happening? Why did they leave us a planet like this? We have got to make sure that that doesn't happen. I have been criticized by many for saying the following, so I will say it again as clearly as I can. No ambiguity. I believe that health care is a right of all people, not a privilege. We have added 17 million people to the ranks of the insured. We have done away with discrimination against women. And then, on top of all of that, you got the drug companies who are ripping us off in an unconscionable way. They are not a very popular industry. Because everybody knows. There is no law. You can go to the drugstore tomorrow and buy medicine you can take for 20 years and the price can be doubled. And there's nothing that right now we are able to do about it. We pay the highest prices in the world, and what happens is that one out of five Americans cannot afford today to purchase the prescriptions that doctors are writing. Seniors are cutting their pills in half because they can't afford the medicine they need. Meanwhile, the three largest drug companies in America last year made $45 billion in profit. They're making incredible profits while people are dying because they can't afford the medicine they need. So, my view is that at a time when we are spending far more per person on healthcare than any other country on earth, and not in some cases getting even the kind of outcomes that these other countries are providing, now is the time to go forward with a Medicare for All single payer program. Is that it is just too late for establishment politics and establishment economics. People do not believe that you can go and have a super PAC, as the Secretary does, and collect millions of dollars from Wall Street and other special interests, and then go out and do what you have to do with the working families. Very few people believe that. So where we are right now is at a moment where we have a chance to bring profound change to this country. And I do not want for one second to make you think that this is easy, nor do I want you to believe, and I say this every day, that any president, Bernie Sanders or anybody else, can do it alone. That is not the way it happens. No change, real change in this country ever came from the top or down. We need millions of people to essentially stand up, flex their muscles, and understand that in our country, if you choose to fully exercise your political power, that's to stop being voted, but really understand that you have enormous power, we will transform this country. The reason we're not doing it is for a variety of reasons. People are demoralized. They are told over and over again, you've got no power. This is the way it is. This is the way it will always be. And you can't do anything about it. Well, I think we can do something about it. 19th, there will be a very, very important Democratic primary here, as you all know. What I have but really understand that you have enormous power. We will transform this country. The reason we're not doing it is for a variety of reasons. People are demoralized. They are told over and over again, you've got no power. This is the way it is. This is the way it will always be. And you can't do anything about it. Well, I think we can do something about it. On April 19th, there will be a very, very important Democratic primary here, as you all know. What I have learned from this campaign so far is that we win when the voter turnout is high, we lose when the voter turnout is low. On April 19th, let us make history, let us have the highest voter turnout in New York State history. Clear that this great state is on the path toward a political